Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. I welcome you all to the fifth week of these lectures, series of these lectures. Today is the 13th lecture, I believe. I am grateful to you all for attending these lectures, listening to me carefully, and trying to understand what I speak about in my lectures. We have so far covered three authors on the fiction side. We have completed our discussion of the Twilight in Delhi, then the Meatless Days, and now it is the turn of Mohsen Hamid's novel, The Reluctant Fundamentalist. All these three novels, they deal with different themes. Although they are modernistic in stance, modernistic in the sense that they talk about what is happening around us in the modern day world. The world, owing to globalization, has turned into a kind of a microcosm. It is a smaller world now, where contacts are very frequent, where distances have been diminished, where time has shrunk, and where people have come closer to one another. And this is not my experience, this is your experience also. You might have had, you know, people with whom you are related who live abroad. You do not feel, you know, isolated from them as we used to feel in the past, when there was no, you know, mass communication technology, when distances were quite remote in length and in terms of time. Now that with the advent of technology, especially this communication technology, things have taken a new shape, and you are lucky to have been born in this age. Very lucky. But you are unlucky also in a certain context. Lucky, all right. Lucky in the sense that you have very many, you enjoy very many facilities and amenities which were denied to your elders, for example, to the generation, to my generation, to the people of my generation. So you are quite lucky in that life has become comfortable, communication has become swift, interaction on different levels has become easy and more frequent than it could have been imagined, say about 40 to 50 years ago. But along with that, there is the other side of the picture also, the bleak side, the, you know, pessimistic side, the result of all this advancement, scientific advancement, and this technological advancement is partly quite, you know, discouraging, quite discouraging. Although in parts it is encouraging, but there is the other side of the picture also. Life has become more complicated now than ever it used to be. Problems of different kinds have erupted in great multitudes, in great numbers. There are social problems, there are moral issues, there are psychological tensions. All this is the gift of the age, the scientific age, the age of ultra modernistic advancement. This is the ironical side of the picture, more bleak. We live in isolation of one another. The paradox is that although the world, the scientific progress and the technological, you know, advancement has brought us closer to one another, the people of the world, they have come closer to one another at the physical level. But alas, there is the other side of the picture, which is that people have become more and more self-centered. They have become more and more, you know, selfish. They feel isolated from one another on the social plane. All this has made our existence.
मुजम्मिल अपना माइक ऑफ कर लें सर. मुजम्मिल का माइक ऑन है, वो इतनी आवाजें आ रही हैं, ऑफ करवा दें प्लीज.
मिर्जा साहब ये माइक बंद करो. So this is the other side of the picture, and you all know what I am trying to convey to you, that there is progress, no doubt, that there is advancement, no doubt, that the life, the pattern of life has completely changed from what it used to be, say some 40 years ago. During these 40 years, the world has seen tremendous progress in different fields of life. And technology is now the ruler. We are being ruled by technology, and this is quite obvious. I need not mince words when I say that technology is now the supreme commander. We move by the internet. We live by the internet. We think by the internet. We even feel by the internet. This is the revolution that has occurred in our times, and to be more specific, in your times. This is something to be taken notice of by you as the, you know, students of literature. Literature makes you more and more aware of life. Literature is a kind of a panacea for many of our, you know, problems, for many of our tensions that we experience in our day-to-day life, for many of the issues which crop up in the diurnal existential situation. Diurnal means daily. In our daily routine of life, we come across so many issues, so many problems, which are a gift, ironically speaking, of modernity, the age of the modern day age, the modern day world, to be more exact. Writers, they, as I've been telling you off and on, they are sensitive people, more sensitive than the common run of humanity. They are like our ears, they are like our eyes, they are like our hearts, they are like our minds. They, you know, guide us, they illuminate us on the intricacies of life, on the delicacies of life, on the horrid existential realities. They enlighten us, they guide us, they teach us even. This is the role of a writer in a literary hierarchy, in a given literary hierarchy. Writers play an important role. It may be Iqbal, it may be Ghalib, it may be Abdullah Hussain, it may be Al Ahmad Surur, it may be Quratul Ayn Haider, it may be Arun Dhatti Rai, it may be, you know, Muhammad Hanif, Zulfiqar Ghos, it may be Waqas Ahmed Khwaja. Any writer, I have tried to recount the names of the writers who are closer to you. Some of them belong to the diaspora, and some of them, they are, you know, natives of Pakistan, and they are living abroad, like Muhammad Hanif, like Waqas Ahmed Khwaja, like Sara Saleri, like Zulfiqar Ghos. These are the people who have forsaken their homeland and they are living in other countries, but they have not disconnected themselves with what is happening in their own homeland. They often talk about Pakistan. They look back to Pakistan in retrospect, and they, you know, enlighten us on how they look at Pakistan from abroad, from a diasporic angle. I'm telling you all this because Mohsin Hamid is one such writer who happens to mostly live in, you know, the United Kingdom, where he has his vocational and professional interests to pursue. Similarly, he visits America quite often, and then he is not far away from us too. He does come to Pakistan here and there. So when he looks at Pakistan, his survey is quite comprehensive, because he would naturally look at Pakistan from an international angle, from a transnational angle, so to say. And in the backyard of his mind, when he's talking of Pakistan, he is comparing Pakistan with, for example, what is happening in the United States of America, what is happening in the United Kingdom. This is how these literary writers, they keep us aware of what is happening in and around us. In means inside us. They talk about what is happening inside us, in our hearts, for example, in our minds, for example. This is what they translate into words, our feelings, our yearnings, desires, fulfilled and unfulfilled, our dreams, our wishes, our missions and visions of life. Literary writers, they give due attention to all this. So they are, you know, penetrative enough to look inside us and to look outside us. What is happening in our mind? What is happening in our heart? How do we react to a certain condition, situation? How do we react to the stark realities of life, as Manto would call them? Manto, you know, he was a short story writer, a Urdu, and he was concerned with exploring the life as he saw it around. He was specifically interested in the lives of the people who were discarded in community, who were, you know, leading a pathetic life, whom people scorned, whom people despised, whom people did not like. This is what the writer does. The writer, wherever he is, he may belong to any community, he may belong to Pakistan, he may belong to any land, starting from New Zealand to Argentina, from Iceland to Sri Lanka, from the Philippines to Colombia to Panama. These are the four corners of the world. So writers, literary writers, they talk about humanity. They talk about the psyche of men. They have a very keen eye as regards the psychological behavior of men and women. This is their favorite, you know, literary menu these days. They talk about the problem that we face in the daily routine of life. The 9/11 experience is regarded as, ironically regarded as, a milestone in the history, in the recent history of the world. Milestone in the sense that the whole world has been affected by this incident, economically, sociologically, scientifically, technologically, psychologically, geographically, and historically too. It is a new historical perspective that has emerged after the fateful collapse of the Twin Towers in New York. The Twin Towers symbolize America's, you know, grandiosity, America's superlative strength in different domains, military, economics, technology, and whatnot. America's superiority as a unipolar power in the world. after the dissolution of the Soviet Union back in the early 80s, 1980s or late 1970s, the world underwent a sea change as far as the location of the power axis was concerned. Prior to that, the world was virtually divided into two invisible, you know, segments. The Soviet bloc and the American bloc. The Soviet bloc people, the nations, the countries who stood in unison with the Soviet Union and the American bloc, the nations of the world, the countries of the world, the states of the world, who supported the United States of America and who looked towards the United States for their economic and sociological sustenance, some of them, of course. This partition of the world into two blocks disappeared. No sooner did the dissolution of the Soviet Union took place. When Soviet Union went to its original shape, it became Russia, and the countries and the states that had been grabbed by the revolutionaries of the communist bloc and included in what was then Russia to maximize it into a huge union of countries lying on the east-west of Asia and in the Central Asian regions. It was a monolithic state of more than 38 or more than 40 units. When Soviet Union was dissolved, all its component units, they became autonomous independent states, and Soviet Union was cut to its size and became Russia. The result was that that one pole of world power was eliminated virtually. The only pole of world power now remained intact. It was America. So America became a unipolar state as far as the center of power was concerned. Mohsen Ahmed had been to America. He went there as a fledgling. Fledgling means a small child. He was hardly 3 years when he first went to America, in California to be more exact, where his father had been, you know, commissioned to do his PhD under a government scholarship. He remained there until the age of 9, came back to Pakistan, and then again at age 18, he went back to America, and this time to be educated at two very prestigious institutions. One, the Princeton University, in New Jersey, and two, the Harvard School of Law, Harvard University, one of the three or four leading universities of the world, Harvard University. It was a highly prestigious educational facility which he could have afforded because of his family background. And then he joined the corporate sector for a while, and a couple of months or 3 to 4 months before the occurrence of the 9/11 tragedy, he immigrated to the United Kingdom, came to London, ostensibly to pursue his vocational interests, his professional interests. It was here that he came to see the 9/11 disaster. I am trying to repeat all this in order to explain to you the significance of this novel in the changed world scenario. It is now a changed world scenario. I have just given you some hints about America becoming a unipolar power. There is no challenge to the power of America. And when you become powerful, Lord Acton, perhaps, who was a political scientist, he said that power corrupts, and absolute power corrupts you absolutely. This is true of America in this sense. And as you know, the situation after the 9/11 episode became quite tense. Mohsen Hamid has so far written about 4 novels. His first novel came in the year 2000, Mass Smoke. His second novel, which is now the subject of our study, it was published in 2007. His third novel, the title of which is How to Get Filthy Rich in Rising Asia. How to Get Filthy Rich in Rising Asia. This is the fourth novel coming into limelight in the year 2014. This was his third novel, sorry. And the fourth one, Exit West, Get Out of West, Exit West. West should get out. Exit West, it was published in 2018. These 4 novels, which is a sizable contribution to the realm of fiction, English fiction, by a Pakistani diasporic writer, a young man. He was born in the year 1971. So his first novel appeared when he was hardly 29. Over the years, he came to published another 3 novels. So these novels 4, and then he has written some essays also. The essays about contemporary art. What is happening in the world of art? This book came into limelight in the year 2009. And apart from that, he has been speaking on different forums. He has talked a lot about globalization, about cosmopolitanism, about the situation in Pakistan vis-a-vis its neighbors, about the situation in Afghanistan, about Iraq, the intervention of America in Iraq. These were the subjects that he's been talking about verbally as well as through his writings. So this novel, the novel that we are presently talking about, projects a situation wherein things have catapulted, things have changed. Chinggis used to feel proud of his being an American, if not by birth, by naturalization. He used to feel proud of being a kind of tool of the corporate machinery of the United States. He had, assimilated himself into the fundamentalist attitude of the American corporate sector, where people were deeply conscious of and were greatly bothered about the fundamentals of business, the fundamentals of industrial revolution, the fundamentals of corporate business. So he was a part of it and he felt very comfortable. His employment with a leading evaluatory firm, Underwood Thompson, was a source of great satisfaction for him, ego boosting. And he happened to be in Manila when the unfortunate incident took place. From Manila, he viewed the whole situation. His immediate reaction was one of surprise and a bit of, happiness. But later on, when he came to America, these are my last words in today's lecture. And I hope you are following everything that I'm telling you about. I'm trying to be very simple. I have kept my speed deliberately slow so that you can pick me up. So when he comes back to America from the short stint that he had in the Philippines, he is, appalled to note a change in the behavior of his colleagues, the American colleagues, the behavior of the people with whom he frequently came into contact with. This was rather very, painful for him. He had great aspirations. And he was on his way to realize some of those aspirations. But then all this shattered his dreams. His dreams were shattered. Then he came to Pakistan for a while, for a repast. And then he again went back to America. This time he was, his employers, they were not very happy with him because of a change in his behavior. He had grown a beard also. And he was not that kind of a smart young man. He went to Chile. I will resume my lecture tomorrow with his visit to Chile, which served as another changing factor in his life, where he met the publisher of a huge publishing house. He talked with him about everything.